Hi and welcome to this video about organization and layout of my workshop. My name is Dennis and I am from Hooked on Wood. The organization of your workshop is one of the most asked questions, and I still get many emails from people asking me to help with this topic. And for the first time, I have contact with another YouTuber, and his name is Peter Millard from 10 Minutes Workshop. So I'm very excited about that. And there's a lot to talk about this topic. So I want to take my time and make more episodes when necessary. And this also allows you to react in the comments. And I can respond to that in the next episode. And I do not know precisely how many episodes there will come, but I want to discuss the placing of my equipment in this episode. And in the next episodes, I want to talk about dust extraction, my French cleat system, and the layout of my new workshop. So an exciting topic, but also a difficult one, because there are so many variables. The layout of your workshop depends on so many things. The size, the shape, and the limitations of your workshop, the equipment you use, what do you produce, and what are your priorities? Because in the end, it's all about priorities and compromises. There's no good or bad in this situation. The limitation of my space are my workshop does not have a concrete floor, so making things mobile is not easy. I have to take into account the water pump for my garden needs some space, and my workshop has a very basic shape and measured around 6 by 3 meters. My priorities are, I want a workshop as clean as possible, so a good dust extraction is essential for me. I want to avoid changing or replacing my equipment. I want everything in a fixed place and ready to go. And if it's really not possible, then I want as little as possible setup time. And I want a nice and pleasant workshop to work in and just enjoy woodworking. The work I make or want to make is various, from small items like some toys to bigger objects like small cabinets or side tables. And when the project stays inside my workbench dimensions of 180 centimeters in length, I can handle this pretty well. But when the projects become bigger, it does not work pleasant anymore. I mainly use veneer wood, MDF and plywood, but I work more and more with solid wood lately, and I want to increase this. This is why I bought the bigger planer jointer and a bigger bandsaw. So that is the angle from which I made my choices and create this workshop. I wanted to mention workflow efficiency at first, because many people ask me about efficiency, and I think it is overrated. I get the idea of cutting a rough piece of wood, putting it through your jointer, going to your table saw and finish it at your miter saw or something like that. You get the point. But this is not how it works in practice. If you have a project, you cut this process into pieces. So we first cut all the timber, then use the jointer and planer, and then your table saw. And we do all these steps in one run. That makes much more sense. So creating space to add the wood during one step is much more critical than the place of the equipment itself. And the same counts when you work with plywood or veneer. You have to think about where you put your wood during this step and if it is nearby. So in my view, it's more important that my machines are easily approachable and they are ready to go without setup time, and I have space around them to add the pieces from my cut list. Most importantly, you have to place your equipment in your workshop. And depending on the number of different machines, this has a significant impact on your workshop's layout. So let us look a little bit closer to my workshop and where all my equipment is placed. In this area, right when you enter my workshop, is my laser, my jointer and planer, my bigger two-stage dust extractor, and my bandsaw. And on the other side is my cabinet saw. And then we go further into my workshop, and there you can find my miter saw, my drill press, and a small sander. And all these machines are in a fixed place and are ready to use when I need them. And at the left wall of my workshop, I have my power tool wall. And of course, most of these products come in sustainers, but I want them hanging on the wall and easily accessible. And I recently changed colors from Makita to Festool, and so I need to make other shelves that fits the tool better. The sustainers are outside of my workshop to create room for other things, and I use what they call a French cleat wall. But I will come to that in another episode. My workbench is a hybrid version of a workbench and router table, and I still think this is a golden combination in a small workspace. Because of this, I have a very versatile router with a large capacity, and when I want to use a router with a fence, this costs me just a little bit setup time. When you are starting to design your workshop layout, I think it's good to start with a drawing on scale. And I use Keynote or PowerPoint for this, but a lot of programs will do. And now I can easily make changes and see how that works out. Do also make items that are important to you. So this is me on scale. And now I can see if I can reach everything, like emptying the barrel of my dust extractor. I also create something that represents the minimum working space I want. And I mean working space, so no walking space. And I think you need at least 70 centimeters to work comfortable. I also drew a board of 200 centimeters long to see if I could handle this on the different machines. And you see I can handle this on my jointer and planer if I open the door. On my miter saw I have more than enough capacity at the right side, but I can only cut around 180 centimeters on the left. And when I want to use my router, I can handle a max of 100 centimeters wide boards. If I have to increase this, I need to remove my miter saw. And I also made an icon representing the minimum saw capacity I wanted. And I could look if I also could store it. And this helped me a lot to create the most optimum layout of my workshop. One of the most essential tools in a workshop is of course a saw. And I work with a table saw, a miter saw, a bend saw and a plunge saw on top of that. And I want to express that you do not need all these kind of saws. If you only have a plunge saw, I think you can almost do the same. But that would ask for a different approach. And before I want to explain why I choose otherwise, I want to tell you more of a workspace placed around a track saw, because I think that can be an ideal solution if you have less space. And for this, I contacted a colleague of mine earlier this day, and his name is Peter Millet from 10 Minutes Workshop. He's also a content creator, but was a carpenter for 20 years and worked a lot with a track saw. Before we go to Peter, I just want to make a quick promotion of my site, www.hookedonwood.online. My China tool series is very popular, and on my site you can find a ranking of all the products I tested, direct links, and where you can find the video of this product, but also free plans of my workbench I showed earlier in this video. So visit www.hookedonwood.online. Thank you. Let's see if it works. Peter? Hi Peter. Nice to see you again.
Hi Dennis, pleasure to be here.
We had contact recently for a video of Peter about the laser engraver I reviewed in episode 23 of my China Tool series. Thank you for taking the time to be part of my video. I really appreciate it. This video is about the layout of a workshop. And I know that you make use of a plunge saw a lot and you have a special table for it. So I wanted to ask you some questions about that. But first, can you tell us a little bit about yourself and your channel?
Oh, sure. My name is Peter Millard. I run the 10 Minute Workshop YouTube channel. I've been a cabinet maker and a carpenter here in London for over 20 years. Started off doing handyman type work and ended up doing sort of a lot of fitted furniture, reasonably high-end wardrobes and bookcases and alcove cabinets and that sort of thing, mostly in the Victorian housing stock that we have here in London. I started a YouTube channel about 4.5 years ago just to help to try and give people some ideas of the basics, because there seem to be a lot of channels that wanted to do fine woodworking and hand-cut dovetails and all that kind of thing, but very few about making a basic MDF or plywood box and calling it a wardrobe. And then that sort of progressed. Last year, I went full-time on YouTube, and that's where we are now. This is what I do for a living. Living the dream, Dennis.
Ah, that sounds perfect. But I'm sure you made some difficult choices for that, so I also found it very brave. I know you do a lot of working with your plunger and you use a special table for that. Can you tell us a little bit how that works?
Yes, I do. Sure thing, Dennis. A big fan of plunge saws. Plunge saws, track saws were one of the things that enabled me to start my fitted furniture business and compete with, you know, the big joinery firms. The table is a standard Festool MFT or multi-function table. And the main thing about it is it's got this grid of holes across the top, which is perfect for clamping. But the real benefit from my point of view is that a simple stop like that and a guide rail that drops down, and you've got a perfect sort of cutting solution. There's a fence at the back here with stops, so you can set this up quickly and easily for repetitive cuts. And I'm sure you agree, Dennis, one of the problems of having a relatively small workspace is that sometimes you need to interrupt your flow of cutting to carry out some other process. And with this, it's really easy because you just set those things off and you've got your bench back again.
Well, that's great and easy. Is such a system expensive?
Unfortunately, it's not a cheap solution. Now, I built a couple of small portable benches recently, and from what I've learned making those, I'm going to be making my own version of the MFT for here quite soon, so stay tuned for that one.
Okay, well, I'm looking forward to that one. Peter, I know you also have a table saw. Do you think working with a plunge saw is an alternative for a table saw, or do you still need that one?
Yeah, I have a table saw. I don't use it much, mostly for very narrow rips and for cutting wedges. And to be honest, I use the MFT for making the narrow rips now, because I've got a couple of very clever little accessories that really help with that. So I might actually get rid of the table saw and just make better use of the space. And so I personally don't really need one, although I understand that many people do like them. I certainly don't really have space for the one that I would like to have, so I may well get rid of this and just be all in on plunge saws.
Yeah, I can understand. And that's why I'm glad you showed us an alternative, because I said earlier in this video, there's no right or wrong here, just choices. Before we say goodbye, I know you are very active on social media. Can you tell us where we can find you in case I'm going to miss you?
Sure, I'm most active on Instagram, to be honest. I'm at 10 Minute Workshop on Instagram. I post to Instagram daily. I'm on the web at 10minuteworkshop.com. If you go to 10minuteworkshop.com, there's a links page there with all the social stuff on it. And of course, 10minuteworkshop.tv will take you straight to my YouTube as well.
Well, choice is enough, I guess. Peter, it was an absolute pleasure to talk to you. Thank you for your explanations and info. And well, we keep in touch.
Absolutely, Dennis. Been a pleasure chatting with you again as well. Thanks so much for having me, and we'll definitely be doing this again. All right, take care.
My English is terrible, but I really like doing this. But I wanted to show this because a plunge saw is a very versatile tool, especially when you have a good and stable one. And it's also very quiet and good for dust extraction. So I do not want to give the idea you need all the saws I have. And of course, working with only a plunge saw has some limitations, but it's a very good option when you can work within these limits. But I mainly use my table saw, and there's a reason it is on that spot. And a typical table saw does have a fence on the right side and a capacity of about 50 centimeters. And if you do bigger projects or you have to cut larger sheets, you need more capacity. And this is possible by placing a fence with more capacity, like I did with my former table saw, or using the left side of your blade. But for this, you need space on the left side. And the same counts when you want to use a crosscut sled. So I placed my table saw as far as I could to the right. And I measured how far I had to place it from the back wall to cut a big sheet when necessary. And I wanted to cut a sheet of 200 by 100 centimeters. And Peter told in an interview that sometimes you need to interrupt the flow of cutting to use the space for other things. And I recognized what he was saying from the beginning when I had a table saw outfeed table solution. And because of that, I wanted to separate the table saw and workbench. And now this is hardly an issue anymore. When I had my DeWalt table saw, I had an outfit table that I could fold away. But when I got my cabinet saw, I made my workbench bigger and added just a small outfit table, but big enough for my average work. When I have to cut bigger boards, they can slide over the workbench. And also my sliding table gives some support for bigger sheets. Because of the space between the table saw and my workbench, I can easily reach my miter saw. And in my early days of woodworking, I did not have a miter saw. With a crosscut sled, you can do a lot of its work without compromises. But when you have to cut longer and heavier boards, a crosscut sled can be a problem. And the biggest problem for me was the limited space I had on the left side of my table saw. So to add this miter saw, I could easily cut longer boards. And by placing it here, I would have the most extended capacity. My workbench of the miter saw could not be much deeper than 70 centimeters to create a 70 centimeter working area between that bench and my workbench. And I think that is a minimum area you need to work comfortably. And a lot of miter saws need more space because of the sliding mechanism. So I had a DeWalt, and that one could easily fit on my workbench. And later I changed it to Festool, and my Festool only needs 2 centimeters at the back, so this fits perfectly on a 70 centimeters deep workbench. And with my Festool, I started to work with it more and more. And now it's fully integrated into my workflow, so practically all the crosscuts within the capacity of my Festool I make with my miter saw. And I think about 50% of the cuts I make with my miter saw, I do not need a fence. So I created a fence that is easily removable. And I use an Incra fence, and the biggest reason for this is the construction they have with these red plates with small teeth. And these teeth lock into place, making a very accurate repeatable cuts possible. The only disadvantage is that they do not have a flip stop, and this becomes really annoying. So now Banggood has sent me so many different T-tracks and flip stops, and I wanted to test them. I think I will make a new fence for my miter saw. If I have to cut sheets too big for my table saw and miter saw, I use my plunge saw. And when I made the bevel cut for this desk, I use my plunge saw, for example, because I can only cut a bevel on a piece of wood shorter than 130 centimeters with my table saw. And at the same counts when I added the bevel at the side of my workbench. The cut with the workbench on MDF worked fine. But I have to say that making this cut in this oak accurate to 45 degrees was not that easy, at least not with my Makita. And this was 25 millimeters oak with a big thicker sides. And I had to try multiple times before I was satisfied. So that was one reason I looked for a Festool. But on the table saw, a cut like this would be much easier and more accurate. The last saw I have is my bend saw. And I upgraded this last year when I decided to build a new and bigger workshop. And I found it too big for my current workshop, and I can use it only for small things, but when I need to cut bigger pieces, I need to move it. This is possible, but definitely not ideal. I want to handle 200 centimeters long material on every machine in my new workshop without moving it. And the same counts for my jointer and planer. I also bought this one already when I decided to build a bigger workshop. But I could place this one much better than I thought. It's not in my way. I can still cut longer sheets on my table saw. And if I have to work with longer boards, I can open my door and handle this. And I'm very happy how this worked out. And although a relatively big machine for my workshop, it fits perfectly. And before I had this one, I used my router as a jointer, which worked, but it's very limited. And I used a smaller planer that I had to place on my workbench. And when you have to make a run of pieces, this is not that much of a problem. But when you have to do this for just one piece, it is a bit annoying. And because I had to put it on my workbench, I also needed to clean my workbench first from materials before I could use it. So that is why placing the most used tools in a fixed place is one of my priorities. That was it for today. In the follow-up episodes, I will show you the limitations of my drill press and how I think you can design a very comfortable and good dust extraction. I want to show you my French cleat system and show you the layout of my new workshop. If you have any questions or suggestions, let me know in the comments. Maybe I cannot react to all of them, but I definitely read them all. And I can come back to some of them in my next episode. I hope you enjoyed this video and found it interesting. And if you do so, please subscribe to my channel if you do not already did it, because it gives me an extra motivation to continue. Thank you for watching. Stay safe, and we will see each other next time.